Ain't no half stepping with Marcus J. We're definitely glad we got you guys listening to us. We see social media is out there blowing up. We're getting a lot of love on MixLR. We're getting a lot of love on Facebook. Tune in. Thank you so much for everybody that's listening to us. I see the lights on in my hometown of Jersey City. I see the lights on down in the ATL. We see y'all listening to us. We got some folks in Delaware listening to us tonight. So definitely want to give a shout out to everybody that's checking out the flagship show of LegacyInternetRadio.com. Ain't no half-stepping with Marcus J. Heard here in the den every single Monday night from 7 to 9:30. At this time, it's time to transition into our monthly segment with the Dating Pool Diva. We call this segment the Diva Diaries. Definitely glad and happy to have her up in here to do her segment. We're playing her little theme music we'd like to play for. It's playing. You can't hear it, but it's playing.
Beyonce.
Yeah, it's playing. So what you got? Let's jump right. Actually, you know what? I had a question that I wanted to ask. Okay. So I don't want to take up too much of your time, but this was a question that came up for me in the last couple of days, and I want to get everybody's. I want Brandy on this one first because she looks so enthusiastic right now. yeah, I'll pick on you too. There was a question that came up about prenuptial agreements, and I won't get into the specifics of how it was presented to me and why I wanted to talk about it, unless it comes up in the conversation. But I just want to get everybody's kind of thoughts on prenuptial agreements. Would you sign one? Would you not sign one? Why not? Start with you, Brandy.
I would sign one, but right now I have my house. I guess that's something you would have to sign for, but I don't know. If we end on it together, we come in with each of our own things, and that's what we're leaving with, each of our own things. If we came in with anything that we got together, we're going to have to sell it and split the money. That's the only way I could think of it.
Well, the reality is the only way that happens is if you have a prenup. Because if you ain't got a prenup and you come in, I mean, the reality is if you come in and you have, you know, certain things and he has certain things and you've been together for a certain amount of time, just because you had, you know, the Ford Ranger, you know, when you came in, don't mean you leaving with the Ford Ranger. You know, it might not go down that way. Now, if you got a prenup and then the prenup says, if we break up, I get the Ford Ranger, then guess what? You get the Ford Ranger. So, you know, that's kind of what I wanted to kind of ask. That's why, what's your thoughts on prenups?
I think it depends on what's in it. Because just like you said, you know, if it's my Ford Ranger, if it's mine and I bought it, I'm not putting it up. I'm not giving it up for anything. It's mine, really. It's mine. So it depends on what's in it, whether or not I would sign it.
Diva?
I'm a hopeless romantic, and I don't like the prenup idea. So I would ask a lot of questions about it and probably
you
be
asking
it.
Questions? Really?
Yeah.
Shocker.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. I would ask questions.
Being that it is a business agreement, you have to sign and get blood tests and all of that. I understand one point of it, trying to make sure that you have the contract fitted for you and him. So that point of it, I do understand. It is a business agreement at one point.
If you love me, why am I signing in the first place?
Big rule. What's your thoughts on prenups?
I'm all for a prenup. I help you draw it up. I have no problem with that. And the reason, and I am on record numerous times by saying this, if for some reason it don't work out, it is not fair to either party for one party to take more than the other. It just is not. Especially when you have built what you create together. It is not fair. And really, especially as a man, what if I decide to marry a woman who makes more money than me? That ain't fair to her. And vice versa. And I'm all about fair. I came in with my Ford Ranger. If I have it, I'm leaving with it. Whatever. Everything else down the middle. That's the way it should be.
I'm going to take the final word on this one and just kind of give you a little history. I was watching a television show. I won't get into which show, but this came from a television show that I was watching. In the television show, the man goes to the woman and says, I want you to sign a prenuptial agreement. She's like, cool, it's no problem. You know, he was like, I'll have it to you tomorrow. And she was like, word, that's cool, but there's a small problem because I won't be able to get mine to you until Friday. And the look on his face when she said that was like, he was like, I got to sign one for you. And she was like, yeah, mm-hmm. you know, and he was feeling some kind of way about that. And so that's what sparked the conversation that I ended up having with several people over the last couple of days, to just kind of gauge what their thoughts are. Here's my thoughts. I have absolutely no problem with a prenuptial agreement. I knew the diva would say no, because I knew that you're a hopeless romantic. I knew Ruben would say that he has no problem with it. I was unsure where Brandy would go, and I was unsure where SY would go. But I have no problem with a prenuptial agreement, regardless of who makes what and how much. And if you make $20,000 and I make $200,000 and we both make $200,000, I could care less. If you want a prenup, just give it to me, I'll sign it. You know, if I feel like I need you to sign one, then it's a deal breaker if you ain't gonna sign it. It's that simple. Because you gotta sign a contract to get married, and you gotta sign another one to get divorced. And so if we're gonna enter into a contract, you know, a business arrangement with my new business partner, who I happen to love and I'm sleeping with, then you're going to sign this paper that says I get to keep my Ford Ranger. And I have Step One Marcus J. Diva. Let's move on. Let's get into the topics that we have here for tonight. What you got?
Okay, I have a topic, a question that was posed by one of my Love Revolution bloggers on Facebook. It's DJ Greg. He posed, do you think a man's definition of love is the same or different than a woman's? Why or why not? So I'm going to go to SY on this first.
A man's definition would be the same, I think.
You think it
would
be the same?
I don't know why. Love is love. It would be the same thing. I don't know why the definition would change.
Okay. What do you think, Big Blue?
I don't understand the question.
Okay, he posed, do you think a man's definition of love is the same or different than a woman's? Why or why not? What love means, is it different to a woman than a man?
Yeah, that's a trick question. Because it all depends on the status and the stature of each person. Because I feel one way about love. Marcus J may feel something completely different, because his stature may be higher than mine or lower than mine. It's one of those things where, I mean, if you're a hopeless romantic, you're all about, oh, I love you, and you got hearts in your eyes and stuff like that. Or if you're getting, you love somebody just because they got money, completely different. I can't answer that question. But I mean, if everybody was a hopeless romantic, of course it's the same. But realism, it ain't. So that's not a fair question. Just my opinion.
Okay.
Well, for me, I mean, I think that, you know, on the surface, you know, the definition of love is the same, but the expression is probably different. You know, how he shows love to her is different than how she shows love to him. You know, and again, going back to traditional gender roles, you know, it may be part of his psyche that I am showing her I love her by buying her flowers, or I'm showing her that I love her by buying her dinner. I'm showing her that I love her by never letting her pull her purse out. You know what I mean? I'm showing her I love her by doing those types of things. Maybe she shows, you know, him that he loves her by, you know, always, you know, not just making the play, that's why, like you said earlier, making sure that you bring it to him, things of that sort. So I think the expression is possibly different. But the definition, I mean, I think that you got to look at the individual person. You know, for that, some people see love is dollar signs. I actually saw an article about a woman who was getting beaten by her boyfriend. Actually, I could say who it was. It was Michelle A, the singer. She was, you know, with Dr. Dre, and then she was later on with Suge, and she was like, she didn't think that Suge loved her because he didn't beat her. You know, and I don't want to make this a conversation about domestic violence, but it's one of those things where it's about the expression. You don't know how a person is going to express love, but it doesn't mean that their definition of it is any different depending on what their gender is, Diva.
I agree. Brandy, I'm going to bring this to you next.
I think I answered it when I saw it on Facebook, but for people that are raised the same way, most of the time I would think that they have the same definition of love. However, they have different ways of showing it, or they may have a different, like a man, what makes him fall in love with the woman would be different than what makes the woman fall in love with the man. I mean, but that's different for any individual person. But if they came up in a house where their parents showed them love from the day they're born, they should know and understand what love is.
We're getting ahead in social media, Kaz, is saying that love is however you feel love. That's That's it. That's all. Some men love femininely and some don't. So it's not the same. I guess I agree with that. When you say some love femininely, that's kind of where you lose me. But I guess I understand the spirit of what you're saying, because, you know, we know some women who are not very affectionate, but an affectionate type of personality trait is always been defined as a feminine trait. You understand what I'm saying? So I get where Kaz is coming from, I guess, in that comment. Diva?
Well, I definitely believe that there's a line between men and women. Yes, there's always exceptions to the rule, but I think that women, being emotional creatures, it's all about how we feel, you know, what you say, what you do, that makes us feel a certain way.
But is that about definition or is that about expression?
It's all one and the same, because my definition of love is what I feel. But to a man, it may be, you know, more practical, like her bringing him his plate or whatever, that shows that she loves him. But it may not be like the same type of feeling that I get from getting hugged, or, you know what I'm saying? Like, I think there's a definite line there. But individuals have individual things.
While I agree with you in spirit, where you lose me is the question that we have as far as the definition versus the expression. I agree with you. I just think that we're misdefining it. Big Rube, what's your thoughts on it, man? You got this look on your face right now. We want to get you in. We want to get you in.
I mean, I'm in, man. I'm in. I just think it's crazy that some women think that men are just not emotional. I mean, to me, I think that's crazy, because just because, I guess, the gender role should state that men are not emotional, men don't cry, they've been taught not to cry since they were a little kid, yada yada. That is not 100% the truth. And I think that you can go both ways, as there are women who are harder than men, who don't cry, who are, regardless of what else, gotta take care of, regardless of how it gets down, they gotta do what they gotta do and not show emotion and get it done. And I think by separating the two and creating it such as men in this way and women this way is incorrect, because when it's all said and done, you don't really know how each person is going to be until you meet that person.
Right. No, I agree. I agree with that, actually. I think where we sometimes get it messed up is we attach tears and crying to emotion. And just because you're, you know, crying doesn't mean that you're emotional. And just because you're not crying doesn't mean that you are, you know. And anybody who spent any time with me can tell you that I am an emotional man. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm someone who, you know, based upon what's going on around me, emotion doesn't necessarily mean that I'm weepy and all of that kind of stuff. But things that happen to people who I care about affect me in a way that I'm involved in it. I want to be involved in it. You know, if I made you upset, I want to know about it. Doesn't mean I'm going to change anything, but I want to know about it. You know what I mean? Things of that sort. And anybody, you know, can see the look on my face if you see something going on in the world and it affects a child. I mean, I've actually seen things on television that have made me weep, like literally cry tears out of my eyes as a grown man seeing things. And it doesn't necessarily always been about, you know, something happened to a child. I've gotten emotional watching a movie. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, I mean, know. I can't sit here and tell you exactly which one, but, you know, I have gotten them. I don't have no shame admitting that. Like, some dudes want to walk around with the macho card and act like they are hard and stuff, but they go home and cry on the floor in the bathroom every freaking day. Hey, that's cool if that's how you carry it, but I'm not going to dive an ulcer at 42 because I didn't express my emotion at 32. That's just how I feel. that's just how I roll, Diva. Or that's why one of y'all got a comment on that. Go
ahead. I was just going to say that it's really hard to define love, period, for men or women. To really put words on it, it's kind of hard. I mean, we associate it to actions, but it's hard to say this is what love means. You know what I mean? Because for everybody, it's a different meaning.
We getting a hit in social media. Kaz is still listening, says, I feel loved by company, but emotional. I'm not used to the hugs and the kisses, but I give it. Let's see. It feels like chilling. That's if I love you. Just want to have you around, which that's cool too. I mean, you know, sometimes, you know, you kind of want to just be around a person, even though you don't really want to touch them or talk to them, but you like the security of knowing that they're in the room.
I like to touch.
That's again. I mean, you like that too, but that's sometimes going back to what I was kind of debating with the diva on as far as expression. You know what I'm saying? Like, you might express love differently. You know, you walk around, you know, the apartment and it's empty and it's like, oof. You know, but as soon as he comes home, you're like, I don't need you come in this room, but I like knowing you in here. But then the flip side is, some of the loneliest feelings a person can have is in a full house. Mm-hmm. And that's real talk. Yeah. Ain't no half stepping with Marcus J. Let's move on to the next question.
Okay. This is straight from the Dating Pool blog book. My first one that I had out last year, and I have a new one coming out this year. This particular topic states, do you have any vices that prevent you from having productive relationships, i.e. excessive smoking or drinking, gambling? Have you had a partner who had advice like these and it destroyed the relationship? So the first question is, do you have any vices? So you have to put yourself out there to say what those vices are. Or you don't have to. You can just skip to the second question. Have you had a partner who has had a vice that destroyed the relationship? So I'm going to start. Let's see. Miss Brandy. Let's see what she has to say.
Do I have any vices? I used to smoke a lot. But the man that I was with told me he didn't like it. So I eventually quit. As of right now, the only vice that I have is enjoying my time to myself. That's probably about it. And I guess it could have a serious effect on a relationship because I'm used to having my time. So I don't know.
That's a good question. That's why, what do you think about it?
If you don't feel comfortable answering the first one, you can answer the second one.
I don't think at this point I have any vices. Mm-hmm. I believe I did at one point, which was being very opinionated. Mm. Like I still do, but there's a way to do things. I always say what I feel, how I feel, whenever I feel it. And that was not the right way to go about getting it out. I have had a relationship where the person had a vice that actually just almost made me want to run to the other side of the globe.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Wow. That's deep.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yep. So.
Okay. Well,
you want big room?
Oh, big room. Is he awake?
Why do you think I'm asleep?
Because your eyes are real tight. Right,
I mean,
there.
But I'm. You know what? Trust me, you know if a brother was asleep, you'd be hearing in the microphone.
Exactly.
All day. Vices? I think the biggest vice I have, probably, not that I have a ton, but the biggest vice I have is not picking up on like nonverbal cues from someone who is either interested in me or someone I'm dating. I guess I'm just that dude. You need to tell me. Mm-hmm. You can't just be like, well, such, hint. I don't do hints. I need to learn how to do hints, but right now I don't do hints. You know, and I would say that's probably the only major vice I have. Have I been in a relationship with someone of vice? I've dated a smoker. That didn't last too long. I guess I don't know. Really, because I don't think I've ever had a. I've never dated anybody who was there as just a. I mean, other than a smoker person, that's had a thing that just like, nah, I can't really work with that. But I guess if it were to tag onto my vice, like, you got to be able to talk to me. Communication is, for me, I like to have communication. I don't like this, you know, behind the woods, I gotta go 3 miles down the street to understand what the hell you're talking about. You need to be up front with me and be like, whatever. I mean, that's not necessarily a bad thing. Yo, if you just wanna, look, we doing this right now, boom. I mean, I'm cool with that, you know, and you can picture it however you choose. But
for me, I don't like subtle cues and stuff like that. I'd rather just be like, yo boy, I need this. All right, I got you. That way I don't misinterpret something. And I mean, it just is. But once again, I don't pick up on stuff either. So like, that's probably one of my biggest problems. If someone likes me, yo, everybody in the room knows but me, because I'm not like that.
I was going to say that I have had a situation where I was interested in someone and they were interested in me, but they gambled like every freaking game that came on the TV. They were gambling. Even ones that didn't come on the TV, they were gambling. So I'm looking down ahead of the future. You live with your family, you're gambling, you're not making that much money. What's going to happen if we get together?
Right.
So
your money,
yeah,
could be gone. As far as me, I can't say that I dated anybody with, you know, any obvious vices, you know, smoker, drinker, you know, the drug addict, stuff like that. I mean, you with people and you have personality clashes which lead to you not being with them. You know, I don't know that I would call those things vices. They just, you know, it didn't work out, but I got two very, very apparent vices. One, I'm brutally blunt. I'm just absolutely brutally blunt, and I can't not be that way. And I know sometimes I need to try to soften it. You know, it would be nice if I could. And honestly, I do try. Sometimes I don't try. It depends on the situation. You know, but I know that that's something that can sometimes, you know, put me at odds with people that I care about, and so I don't like upsetting them, but sometimes it just kind of comes out as it is. You know, it's something that I'm aware of, but you know, sometimes being aware of something and doing something about it are entirely two different things. You know, she makes fun of me. See, I thought we was gonna have an honest discussion.
You made S.Y. cry.
She wouldn't be the first I made to cry.
Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, all right. But here's the other thing. A very clear, Kaz is actually saying she's blunt as well. Sometimes she can help it, sometimes she can't. Either way, it is what it
is.
Kaz, Kaz and I, we share that. My other vice is the older I get, the more obsessive, absolutely obsessive I become about my sports teams. You know, to the point where, you know, the Yankees and the Knicks and the Giants, they hold a place in my heart and in my universe that's very important to me. And I know that, you know, to people who ain't into sports, you know, you sometimes can think that I'm a crazy person. And trust me, I sometimes think that I'm a crazy person. How these people, you know, that are playing in a football game, you know, 300 miles away can absolutely affect my mood, you know, which will in turn affect the mood of the people that's around me. I get it. Trust me, I get it. I know, you know, I remember a time, you know, in the 90s where the Knicks were playing well and they end up losing a big game. This is back in the days where I used to wear a jersey for every game. Like, I don't do that no more, but I used to wear a jersey for every game. They lose the game, I snatch the jersey off and I throw it in the corner and I wouldn't let nobody touch it. And it sat there for like a week on the floor. And I wouldn't let nobody touch it. And every time I walked past it, I stepped on it. Like, I was like that mad, you know. And I get into it, you know. I get into it with Mrs. J. One time we had a fight about sports, and you know the Knicks had lost, and she was like, "What's the problem? It's just a game." And she gave me an attitude. And it's like the worst thing that you can do, ladies, of your guy and guys, you know, because I know there's some dudes that don't like sports and ladies who do. You know, if you with somebody and in the sports, the worst thing you can say is it's just a game. Like, don't ever say that, because I was like, just a game. I was like graduation from college, having babies, getting married, the Knicks winning the title. It's all equally important to me. Like, real talk. And at the time, I meant it. And so, you know, we talking about vices. I'm gonna need you to not look at me with the judging. Well, actually, you can judge me all you want. I don't care. But like, that's just for real. So that's my vice. Sometimes.
So, do you still feel that way about the games?
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. And depending on the importance of the game or what time of the season it is, you know, my participation in a conversation with you is dependent upon what's going on the game. It's real talk. You ask me, and that's a vice of mine.
I know, but you do realize it really is just a game.
Look, Yeah, I know, but this
but
is
it's his life.
This is what it, this. I mean,
but we, it doesn't bring any bread in the house.
No, it doesn't. But you know, this is how I feel. Everything ain't about bringing bread in the house,
unless you're gambling.
Yeah, you know, I almost went there, Brandy. But, but everything isn't about you know. You get, you know, we all know what dopamine is, and we all know that is the chemical inside the brain that makes you feel good. And every single person has different dopamine triggers. And so if your dopamine trigger is to smoke weed, or if your dopamine trigger is to have sex even when she sleep, you know, if your dopamine trigger is to you know, gamble, you know, if your dopamine trigger is to do whatever, it is what it is. And you can work to try to change it if it can have a negative impact on your life. You know, it may, you know, my obsession with my sports teams may have negative impact on my personal relationships from time to time, but it's something that obviously I have control over. You know, I'm not going to, you know, run somebody over in the street if the Giants lose, because if I'd have done that, I would have done that 3 weeks ago, 2 weeks ago, and yesterday. you know, it is. I'll probably be doing it next week too. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, it is what it is. But no one else got the judging eye but me just now. And I'm not feeling some kind of way about it, because I don't really care if y'all judge me on it. It
kind of is. Why do you feel that way? You shouldn't feel that way,
girl. Please, you was looking at me with the rock eye.
I mean, but
yeah, eyebrow was up.
You smell what Sharon's thinking.
You know what I'm saying? you know what I'm saying. So Diva, do you want to share anything else?
Well, I will share. My major vice is I'm overly sensitive, and it can come across as defensive. And so in relationships, especially with men, I guess they don't really get that, you know, or understand why I'm so sensitive, but it's just my way. It's just my personality.
You know, I noticed that about you.
Yeah. I'm extremely sensitive, and people take it more as I'm mean and I'm being nasty, but it's actually me reacting to something that I've heard or something that has been done to me or whatever. And it may not even be a major thing. It may be something small to that person, but to me, it was like his football team and his baseball teams. Like, to me, whatever was said, it impacted me.
Right.
Yeah, so that's my major vice. I've been working on it.
I guess, you know, I think that depending on the vices, you know, I think it's incumbent upon the partners to assist with regards to those vices. Mm-hmm. You know, like if I was to address your vice, Diva, I would say that whoever you're with should realize that you're sensitive and try to, you know, not so much cater, but try to curtail some of their conversations in a more softer way to assist you with dealing with it. As far as Brandy is concerned, I assume that you're not seeing that fella any longer. But if you were, you know, if that person, you know, was still gambling, you know, I don't know how you. You know, assist them with gambling, but no. You know, maybe not throw $100 on it, maybe throw $20 on it.
No, it didn't even get to a start. It just was thinking,
right,
what would happen.
Right. I mean, I guess with my advice, I mean, you know, you either going to be down with watching the games or not. Like, no one is going to be into you. Well, I should say no one. I do know some sisters that's as into the teams as the husbands. But, you know, I guess for someone who suffers the vice that I suffer, because trust me, it's suffering. Yesterday was not a good day at my house. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, yeah, give me those tissues too. You know, but I mean, I guess if you have someone that you can share your, I guess for lack of a better term, problem with, it's easier. A couple of hits, Kaz is saying her friend says that her vice is that she's not very affectionate. But what she's saying as far as the game, you can't even say that it's not a game, because it does be that serious. And Joy also is saying that she's very sensitive as well. So so we have some people that share. Brandy, what you got?
Does a vice necessarily have to be something bad? Or is it that you can do something so much that it becomes a vice because it's detrimental to the relationship?
I think, like, if you said, oh, I'm sorry.
No, I was just going to say, like me, I love to dance. Right. I'll go out salsa dancing, I'll go to the reggae clubs. I love to dance.
Right.
And it would probably interfere because most of the time I don't want nobody going with me. Right. No, you're not. Mm-mm.
Right.
So,
but I don't think that, well, I think that when you use certain words, they have negative connotations mm-hmm. based on the word. So when you say vice, mm-hmm. the word vice has a negative connotation. Like if I said, I love your odor, like, huh?
Right. And in this scenario, it's talking about how it prevents you from having a productive relationship. So yes, the vice is bad.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, like I said, you know, certain words have negative connotations. So
that's what it was.
What?
Now that you said, I love your odor. That's why you were dancing on the chair, because I smelled Egyptian musk.
That's what it was? Oh, okay. Yeah, because, you know, because most of the time people just look at me and they'll say, what's that you wearing? What's that you wearing? And they'll never know. But you actually said the name Egyptian musk, and people normally don't. So I was like, I've been wearing it for 20 years.
That's me.
Yeah, that's what it was. Yeah, I jumped on the chair. I was like dancing, like Spike Lee was. Remember the butt video with Stipes was on the chair like that and whatnot. So,
okay,
yeah. So anyway. Next question. What we got next?
Okay. To wrap all this up, this is what we discussed this weekend at the forum, at the Love Revolution Forum we have monthly every third Saturday. And we discussed relationships and being able to know when a relationship is worth fighting for and when it's not, when it's destructive. So the question is, how do you know when you're in a toxic relationship? And how do you avoid dating the same guy or girl over and over again? So the first question, how do you know you're in a toxic relationship? I'm going to take this to Big Rube over here.
You know you're in a toxic relationship when you can't stand to be around someone before you start arguing uncontrollably. I hate arguing with a passion. Mm-hmm. You want to get rid of me? Let's argue all the time. Yeah. I'm out. Because I'm not, you know, I don't got that kind of time. Because I don't have a crazy temper. But, you know, I would say that for me, it's all about defense. It's like, look, it ain't worth it. I mean, it could be the smallest thing, you know. And if I get to a point where it's like, all right, you win. Ain't no big deal. Let's mm-hmm. go. Nah, that's just, then it becomes unnecessary. Mm-hmm. I've waved the right flag.
Yeah.
You know, it's a done deal, but yet you still want to argue about it. Yeah, that's toxic. I'm out. Mm-hmm. I ain't got time for that.
Yeah, I agree. When it gets to where it's uncomfortable for me, it's uncomfortable for you, you know, the relationship is more of a problem than anything. It's definitely time to go. It obviously can't be fixed.
Prepared.
If we're both, you know, going at each other like that.
Okay. Brandy?
you're not sure where you're gonna go, Brandy. Brandy is got the face on right
see,
now.
See, my thing is, when I'm not feeling like something's right, I'm quick. Cut it off. Don't talk to me no more. I don't know your phone number. I don't erase. I'm not good with dealing with that. If it's gonna cause me stress, I don't need to be in it. We're supposed to be in this together to make each other happy. So
mm-hmm.
that's it.
Yeah, I mean, I guess if we're asking how do you, so the question is, how do you know that you're in?
Yes.
A toxic relationship. You know that you're in a toxic relationship when you never, you find yourself unhappy more than you're happy. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And it may have snuck up on you. You know, you wouldn't even, you didn't even see it happen. You're like, oh, yeah, I'm not happy. You know what I mean? That's when you might know, you know, and I guess at that point you got a choice. You know?
Right.
You can either do like Brandy said and be out or continue to not be happy. You know, I mean, that's how you could tell. It seems like a simple, but it's really not. But mm-hmm. then it kind of really is.
Right. So. Right. So in those situations, they're never able to be fixed or repaired. Are we agreeing on that?
I guess they could be. I mean, well, yeah, I think you could be because you got to have a buy-in of both parties and acknowledgement of the feelings of the person that's feeling unhappy and feeling that the situation is toxic. If I'm making you sick, if I'm the one that's making you sick and I know that I'm making you sick, then I got a choice. Am I going to continue to make you sick or am I going to stop making you sick? Are we going to try to heal you together? And if the answer is no, then you got a choice. Are you going to remove yourself from me making you sick? Or are you going to stay there and we're going to be sick together? You know, I don't know. I mean, that's this is the one that's got everybody kind of holding the mic away from them right now. like no one really wants to jump in on this one. But you know, it's one of those things where, you know, you got to kind of try to figure out a way to take care of yourself. I mean, there's plenty of people walking around in toxic relationships, and they find other ways, you know, to deal with it. And so you basically treating symptoms but not problems.
And then it becomes different if, you know, depending on the length of time in the relationship. And is it a relationship or is it a marriage? Mm-hmm. You know?
Well, it's more challenging when it's a marriage, that's for sure.
Legally. Yeah, but I would think that you'd want to fight a little bit more for it if it's a marriage. That you would want to try to fix it if it's a marriage. Because if it's just I'm dating you and we're doing this back and forth business, then you know what? I got a headache. I got to go.
Yeah. I mean, you may not. And the reality is you might get caught up in a routine and you may not even have the energy to fight.
Just walk, man. Just walk.
It's like the person that's terminal that won't get the treatment.
Yeah. It's like, really, you know, stupid.
Well, I was just going to agree with you and say that that's absolutely right. If you're telling the person that this is the issue, but they continue to do it over and over again, it's up to you to stay and keep going through all that punishment or to leave.
Mm-hmm. Big rope.
I mean, I think the only way a toxic relationship can be worked out is called go see a professional. Because, you know, it comes to a time when you two cannot communicate properly. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you need a different setting to communicate properly. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's nothing wrong with getting a third party involved, mm-hmm. whether you have to pay for it or whether you have someone in your camp who is good enough for it between both of you and can stay objective enough and not choose sides and get it done. That's probably not going to happen, so you got to go pay for it. Mm-hmm. But, you know, if y'all two are really in love and you want to try to make it work, I'm all about trying to make it work. But, you know, if you're not going to try to make it work or you say you're going to do it and half-ass it, then you've half-assed it. It's a done deal.
Mm-hmm. Well, the second part was how do you avoid dating the same guy or girl? So now you're out of the toxic relationship. How do you avoid from getting into another one that's similar to that?
You can't. The reason why you can't is because you don't know who you're getting involved with until you get involved with them. Because if you sit there assuming that every person is going to be like that, then you're not going to date anybody.
So you don't think there's any signs or symptoms of a similar person, like abusive person, for instance?
Well, I mean, everybody's different. You know, and I'm not saying that they're not signs, but it's up to you to make determinations where is this one worth it or not. But to be perfectly honest with you, I guess we all fall into our same categories, you know. I like this one, this type of woman or whatever, whatever. But every woman, ultimately every person is different. Just because they may have some similar characteristics, they may not be the person that you left, you know. And like I used to, I have said, you know, sometimes men get the sin of ex-boyfriends syndrome.
Right.
Whereas it's not the fact that this dude is like the dudes you had. It's like, wow, this is kind of similar. Do I really want to take that chance? Well, because this happened to me. I mean, you know, it's one of those things you just got to test out. But, of course, if you see, especially abuse, there are some times you're going to see. The first time he tries, yeah, you got to roll out. No question.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, but you can't sit there living like it's never going to happen. Because somebody may have some one thing that's similar to your ex-boyfriend's. And it may have he may have nothing else comparative to it. So you got to just take a chance. But, you know, I understand having your blinders up. Well, not your blinders up, your defense up. Mm-hmm. But you got to know when to give it a fair shot. Because if you don't give it a fair shot, you just waste your time.
I agree. I definitely agree. That's why.
I agree with him. Every dude is not the same. You know, what the past one did, the next one may not. Just because something may be similar doesn't mean that you're going to fall into that catastrophe that you were in before. So, I mean, there are signs when there's something as drastic as, like, abuse, like you said, and things like that. Yeah, you want to pay attention to the lesson that you learned the last time and look out for those things. But until you're actually in the relationship, you really won't know what you're up against.
I think the other thing that we haven't mentioned here is that we all have personality traits, and our personality traits, you know, attract other types of personality mm-hmm. traits. And what you put out there is what you receive. Mm-hmm. You know, because we talked about dopamine before, something that you can't see. But you know what else you can't see? You can't see pheromones. And so mm-hmm. if your magnetic, you know, your magnetic pull kind of goes out there, and someone who, you know, is attracted to your personality traits, or you're attracted to theirs, they don't always have to be positive mm-hmm. personality traits. And that's where you see, you know, men attracting the same type of women and women attracting the same type of man. And so if those people that you're attracting are toxic, then you need to figure out a way to break that cycle and try to see if you can find yourself engaged with someone that is more positive in your life. Because if you can't do that, then you're gonna have a lifelong problem, Diva.
I was getting ready to say, to piggyback off what you just said, self-esteem has a lot to do with it too. Mm-hmm. If you're kind of a weak person where you don't feel good about yourself, you'll fall into these situations of toxic mm-hmm. relationships easy. You know, so you got to kind of analyze yourself, too, mm-hmm. before you start looking for a relationship.
Yeah. Yep. You know what else might also help? Real talk. Sometimes you got to keep old girl locked down until you figure out who you're dealing with. Because some women just maybe go a little too fast in the bed department. I mean, you ain't got to give it up 1, 2, 3, 4, whatever. I mean, sometimes you just need to wait. If it's 3 months, it's 3 months. If it's a year, it's a year. If he really wants to be with you, he a real man, he will stay. Mm-hmm. It's important, but it's not like a deal break. Like, if I'm in love with you, not having sex for a certain amount of time is not a complete deal breaker.
Mm-hmm. Speak for yourself, bro.
I mean, I'm speaking for myself. Okay. But I'm just saying, I mean, it's one of those things you got to choose.
It's a deal breaker.
I mean, that's cool for you.
Yeah, for me. Ain't no ass tap on Marcus yet. What the hell y'all laughing at? What y'all laughing at? Why are you rolling your eyes at me?
My eyes haven't rolled.
Well, okay, then why are you staring at me?
I mean, because God, we didn't even ask you, and he did say, if I am in love with you.
Yeah, but we having a discussion.
Well, speak for yourself, but if I.
Hey, man, y'all ain't going to be challenging me. I'll be here. That's not how this going tonight.
It's going. Looked like it went, didn't
it?
No,
it really did.
It did.
What you gonna do, y'all?
We already did.
What you gonna do?
It was already done.
Ding, 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 ding.
It was already done. It was already done.
I'll tell you what.
Tonight you can play it back and hear where you missed it, because it was already done.
I ain't missed nothing.
It was done already.
It wasn't nothing done.
Checkmate.
Go ahead and move on, Diva, before I go in on this one.
Checkmate.
I've touched this
in your face.
I don't even play chess, so I don't know what that means.
I'm pretty much touched me. What I wanted to touch tonight.
Came me.
I thank everybody for being honest and open with their feelings.
You guys crack me
These
up.
These were some deep questions,
you?
So I appreciate it.
Ain't no half stepper, Marcus J. We're going to take our final break of the night, try to get rid of some of these giggles, take our final break of the night, and we come back. We got our rants and we got our closings. We're going to close out the show. Got the S.Y. Butler, the Dating Pool Diva, Brandy, and Big Rube, and I'm Marcus J. Stay with us.